The title of the program today is Preparing for Election Day 2020. If you are joining us on one of several platforms, let me note that we are broadcasting live on BCTV, and we're accepting comments or questions that are germane to the election topic on Microsoft Teams, on the Q&A function, and on Facebook Live and YouTube Live on the comments section. If you would like to ask a question or make a comment, we must have your first and last name, as well as the municipality where you reside. If you are from the media, we just need your name and the media that you are representing. This afternoon on our program, I'm going to start by making a few comments. I'll turn it over to Commissioner Rivera for some opening comments, and then to Commissioner Barnhart. Commissioner Barnhart will be leading the program. He is the chair of the Berks County Election Board and actually has been the chair since he took office back in 2008. The 2020 election cycle is like no other cycle I've been involved in, even before being a county commissioner. And I guess you could say 2020 is like no other year any of us have experienced. And when you layer several issues on top of one another, I think it may help people see what makes this so difficult. We already had a pretty intense political environment coming into 2020. But in addition to that, 2020 is the first year that Pennsylvania is using a mail-in ballot system, and there have been numerous tweaks since that was first passed as part of Act 77 in the fall of 2019. And then layer on top of that, COVID-19, and you have a recipe for a very challenging time. I just want to take a minute and thank our election department, Karen Barsom, our deputy director, Donna Blatt, our chief registrar, have done a great job leading that organization. Our staff have put in incredible hours, and a lot of this pressure really began in March and has continued and really will continue beyond Election Day, because their job isn't done until the election is certified. Christine Sadler and Ron Seaman have really stepped up in recent weeks with the departure of Debbie Oliveri. And we have quite a number of county employees that will be working on Election Day into election night, possibly even into the early morning hours Wednesday, depending on how long that takes. But I would ask one thing. We're all in this together. Our objective is to have an election that the voters can trust the results, that they can know with certainty when they cast a ballot, whether it's an absentee ballot, a mail-in ballot, or they vote in person, that their vote is going to count in the way they intended it to count. We are doing everything to ensure the security, transparency, and reliability of this election. I know Commissioner Barnhart will talk about a lot of those details, but it's important to understand that we take this very seriously. In our role as election board, the party we have as a label doesn't matter. What matters is the integrity of the election. That's all I have to say, at least at this point in time. And I want to turn the meeting over for some comments to Commissioner Michael Rivera. Commissioner Rivera.
Commissioner Leinbach, thank you very much. And I also want to start by thanking the team down in Election Services. They've been doing a great job there together with Commissioner Barnhart, who's the chair of the board, Ron Seaman, Christine Sadler, and everyone else involved in the department there. They've been working long days, long hours. So thank you to everyone in the department there for all the work that you're doing. Something that surprised me a little bit is before I would go out and vote, and you know, you would look at the elections as the day that you got and vote, and that you're putting the information in a machine, and that that information gets tabulated and the results appear and you know who the winners are. But through the primaries and now through the general elections, I've had the opportunity to go down and meet with the people down in election services, learn more about what they're doing. I was just there earlier today and saw the tons and tons of paperwork they're doing there, the tons of things that they have to do, that's manual labor that is not computerized to be able to get everything done for election day. So it's not just November 3rd, which is election day, and that's for work. They have been working on this for weeks and for months, and there's just an amazing amount of work that goes into making sure that when you go either on November 3rd to enter the information, or when you requested your mail-in ballot, that everything was done right, that all the information is counted properly, that what you see on your ballot is what needs to be there. So there's a lot of effort that goes into making sure that every vote counts and that every person is able to vote in the right way, because the candidates change from precinct to precinct. So there's not just one ballot, there's a different ballot depending on your district, on your precinct, who's running. So there's really a lot that goes into this, and something that I want to suggest to the election board at our next meeting is maybe if we would do it, not now for the presidential elections, but for next year, do some type of filming of what goes on behind the scenes, just so people are aware of the immense work that goes into making sure that there's a proper election held each and every year, actually two times a year. So I think that would be something that would benefit the residents of the county to learn and understand more about what goes on behind the scenes at election services. So again, thank you to the team for all the hard work that they put into this, to the people that are there working temporarily as well. Just ran into someone today that was from Penn State Extension, someone from the Library Systems Department, that they're working here to make sure that everyone is able to vote, and that every vote counts on November 3rd or before, whenever you may have voted. So again, thank you to everyone for the work that you're putting in there. And thank now, you. Go ahead, Commissioner Leinbach. I was going to introduce Commissioner Barnhart, but go ahead.
Okay, yeah, I thank you very much, Commissioner Rivera. I just want to share, because I'm not sure the Commissioner Barnhart will say this, several weeks ago, he offered to his colleagues and to the election department to be the point person for the many, many questions that come in regarding elections. The pressure on the folks in the election department and the leadership team of Karen Barsom and Donna Blatt, they need to be so focused on making sure that every aspect of the election and the process is done properly. I'm not sure Commissioner Barnhart would do it if he had to do over again, because he's gotten a lot of questions, some of them more unusual than others, but we appreciate it. And this has been a focus that Commissioner Barnhart has had really since he first started in office. And I, for one, really appreciate his attention to detail when it comes to elections. And with that, I'll introduce the vice chair of our Board of Commissioners, as well as the chair of the Berks County Election Board, Commissioner Barnhart.
Thank you, Commissioner Leinbach and Commissioner Rivera. And I certainly thank you. And I want to echo your comments about our staff and our extended staff, the leadership, Pamela Shupp, Ron Seaman, Christine Sadler, Jessica Wieknack, our HR director, has stepped in. Cody Kaufman, our new county assistant solicitor, has stepped in when needed to really help out. So we've coalesced, we've come together. And one of the comments that Commissioner Rivera said really struck me. You only see a little piece of election services. It's almost like a iceberg. You only see 20%. But if you really saw what goes behind the scenes, you would be blown away by the magnitude of the work that it takes to pull off an election. I'm joined today by my esteemed panel. It's Ron Seaman, our Chief Administrative Officer of the County of Berks, and Christine Sadler, Solicitor for the County of Berks. These two people have a long history of election services work, as well as election law. So I want to get started on our overview, and what we're going to discuss today is basically what to expect on Election Day, November 3rd, which is a short few days away this coming Tuesday, and what's taking place. So I want to throw a few numbers at you. We have a slide prepared to show you some of the significant number changes from the primary to the general. As you can see on the screen, our total number of registered voters in Berks County has increased to 272,296, 118,400 of the Democratic Party, and 110,430 of the Republican Party. So I frame that in the context of, if you generally look at a general presidential election, about 70% of the voters will come out and cast their ballot, either in person or by mail or absentee. So that is, we have 82,967 ballot requests out for absentees and mail-in ballots, 82,967. So 70% of that number is 190,607, leaves us with about 107,000 voters who are likely to come out on Election Day to our 202 polls. So that's well over, if you split them right down the middle, that's over 500 people per poll. Why do I say that? Don't expect to rush in and rush out of the poll on Election Day. The machines were put into place last fall. They're ballot marking devices. We will get into details with Ron as to exactly how they work. But for many of you, it'll be the first time you have used a machine if you elected to vote in at the polls. So it's going to take a little time. We're certainly going to have people socially distance, wear a mask, and all the safety precautions will be in place. So I wanted people to be aware of that. So far, we have received about 57,000 responses to the mail-in ballots, which is tracking about 67%. So they still need to come in through the balance of this week into the weekend. And if they're postmarked by Election Day, they can be counted up to Friday after the election. So there's still a lot of work after the election. There's so much before, but there's also so much after. And as these deadlines, like register to vote has passed, applying for mail and absentee ballot has passed, the poll books have been printed. So now the election services now pivots to getting all the materials ready for the 202 judges of elections to get that distributed on Saturday to 202 judges of elections. To continue to have classes throughout the weekend for interpreters and for poll workers. We have had several judges of elections and some machine inspectors who have called in and said, I can't work because of COVID-related issues. And we thank you again. Over 500 additional people have requested if we needed their help to run this general election out at the polls. So my hat's off again to our county. When times are tough, the people in Berks County stand tall. So I just wanted to highlight where we're at number-wise, and I'd like to turn this over to Ron Seaman to discuss in detail mail-in ballots and drop boxes. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner Barnhart. Yesterday was the deadline to apply for a mail-in ballot. So if you have not done that at this point in time, you're only permitted to go to the polls and vote in public. If you have made application, you still haven't returned your ballot, you can do that in a number of different ways. We have drop boxes located here at the County Services Center and also at the Berks County Agricultural Center. Those hours of availability for those drop boxes are tomorrow and Friday from 8 a.m. to 7 p.m. And then on Saturday, they will be closed because of the distribution of the supplies. Sunday, they're closed. Monday, they will both be open from 8 a.m. to 5 p.m. And on Election Day, both of them will be open and available to receive ballots from 8 a.m. to 8 p.m., the time that the polls are open for voting. You can also bring them into the elections office if there's some issue with not receiving your ballot. You can, as long as it's been applied for by yesterday, you can make arrangements by coming into the office. They'll cancel the ballot, give you a new ballot, and allow you to vote and leave it here. So far, we've been having pretty good success with the drop boxes. For the last week and a half, I've primarily been going to the agricultural center. We had a banner the first day it was in operation on the 19th. We brought 1,153 ballots back. Since then, it's significantly curtailed. Yesterday, there were 681. But there's still quite a number being dropped off at those both those locations. I will commend the board for taking the appropriate steps that they did in securing those drop boxes by having deputy sheriffs observe their use. I'm not sure how many people were aware, but there was a headline on Monday in Boston. Somebody used an incendiary device and dropped it into a box and burnt most of the ballots that were in there. We have not had those types of things happen here in Berks County. And that's why we haven't had more than the boxes that we did have. We want to make sure that they were secure and everybody's vote was protected. That's about all I have at this point. I'll be happy to answer any questions that come up as we proceed. But if you have any questions, do not hesitate to contact us. You're muted.
I try not to do that. Thank you, Ron, for your insightful information, and we will be calling on you as questions start to filter in. One significant change to this year is obviously how mail-in ballots will be processed. Going back to, as Commissioner Linebach alluded to, Act 77 allowed people now for the first time in Pennsylvania to have a no-excuse absentee ballot, which is called a mail-in ballot. There are still absentee ballots for other medical and unrelated reasons, but you can apply for a mail-in ballot. How are we going to process those? In the primary, we had about 38,000 that actually came back. That was a combination of absentee and mail-ins. They were done here in the large room, the 13th floor commissioner's boardroom. They were done over a 2.5-day period, Tuesday, Wednesday, half a Thursday. So we wanted to step that up much more for the general. We added additional automatic envelope openers, three of those, as well as three optic scanners. So we had literally one envelope opener and two optic scanners in the primary. So if you're looking at 82,000 mail-in ballots and they all come in, there's a lot of work involved. We also, the Board of Commissioners and as the Board of Elections, I wanna thank you again. We engaged BCTV to audio and video record the entire process of the pre-canvass. So what is going to happen at 6 o'clock Tuesday morning is a load of ballots on carts will be transported from election services to the Doubletree Ballroom. All of this will be recorded from 6 a.m. till the completion of that day. And then the recording will continue Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. As the additional mail-in ballots come in, as the additional absentees, military, overseas, and provisionals come in from the polls. So it's a real integrated process. We are going to then have actually on two shifts. The first shift will be 160 plus county employees working socially distanced in the ballroom to open up both envelopes, the outer envelope or the interior secrecy envelope to get to the ballot, fold that ballot back so then it can be moved to the secondary room at the Doubletree and scanned in. So that process, we have a first shift of 160. We have 93 people backing them up on second shift. We think we have sufficient resources, equipment, and staff to get the job done. The staff will be overseen by team leads and supervisors. And I think we're gonna have a great process at the DoubleTree. Our expectation is to be out of there the same day, to have these ballots, completed ballots that were scanned in back to the secure location and election services. And then a remainder as they come in, as I pointed out earlier, will be processed here in the 13th floor commissioner's boardroom. Again, it will be recorded each and every move, audio, video. We did not have to do that. The state was contemplating to have an amendment to the law, which required counties to do it. We didn't want to wait till the 21st or 23rd of October to make that decision. We made it, and I think it's going to be a great outcome. It will not be live streamed. It won't be something you can watch in the comfort of your own home during election day, but it will be made available if someone desires to view it later on down the road. So again, we're going to have social distancing, sanitization. We're going to have prepared food for our people to eat separate from the ballots. There'll be an off to the side break room for getting water and snacks and washing their hands and coming back. We don't want anything to have a process that's clean for the ballots. We don't want to have any errors there. But our expectation, as I said, is to get everything done on election day. We think we have the equipment and the manpower to do this. And we don't want to be that county that they're waiting for the next day or several days after because we didn't become proactive knowing that there was going to be a huge number of mail-in ballots coming in. So with that, I'd like to turn this over to Ron and discuss what it's going to be like on election day, voting in person, what COVID-19 safety precautions will be in place at the polls, and other observations at the polls. Ron?
Thank you, Commissioner. There will be signage posted at each polling place reminding people about social distancing, the wearing of masks. We will have protective equipment available for our poll workers as well as the voters in general. Each polling place will have ample amounts of hand sanitizer. There will be gloves available for the voters to utilize if they wish. There also will be Q-tips available that they can use to activate the machines rather than touching the screens with their bare fingers. We have secured 70% alcohol wipes, which are safe to use on the computer screens so that they can be sanitized after voters use them. We will have additional masks if people forget to come in with a mask, or if something happens to one, tears or whatever, they'll be able to get a mask to use. There'll be protective plexiglass shielding the voters from the election board people as they sign their books. If we will be sanitizing the pens that will be given to the voters to sign the poll books. If you prefer not to utilize them, even though we will be sanitizing between uses, bring your own writing device, a blue or black ink pen, to sign the poll books. It's pretty much a straightforward process. If you have not used the new voting machines before this, do not hesitate to ask for assistance from the judge of election or the machine inspector. They will give you a brief overview of what the process entails before you get in there and find that you have some difficulty in casting your ballot. Once you've made your ballot selections and you insert your card, it gets printed out. You can look at it, verify that this is who you intended to vote for, and then put it in the optic scanner, and that completes the process.
Thank you, Ron. And for those who did not vote last fall or the spring, the machines are different. They're not the full-face machines. They're ballot marking devices, similar to when you're ordering something at a fast food establishment. That does not record a vote. That simply records onto a card, which then you verify that that's the selections you want to make. That then, when you are sure that you want to put that in the optic scanner, the large black unit, when you're leaving the poll, that actually scans it in to the system. That's actually when your vote gets counted into a flash drive, gets uploaded to a flash drive. Now, recognizing that some people want to know why they can't leave the poll with that, no county or any state allows that to happen. You can't simply leave the poll with proof of who you voted for. But what that gives us for the first time is a backup in case there is a question about a result, whether there's a question about a machine, whether there's a tie vote somewhere or a closely contested race. We now have that backup, which we didn't have before for probably 30 plus years, was it was in a cartridge. Now we not only have the flash drive, but we have that card without a name, without an identifier on it, that we can go back and hand count those if necessary. So there's a lot of changes, whether it's the machines, whether it's Act 77, it's a lot of it's exciting. Some can be nerve-wracking and frustrating, but we're gonna get through this together. Next, I'd like to call on Christine Sadler, our county solicitor, to really go through something that's different, not the poll watchers, but observers actually watching the pre-canvassing and canvassing process. A lot of new things happening and a lot of requests to actually view and review what's taking place, whether it's at election services, in the commissioner's boardroom, or on election day at the Doubletree. Christine?
Thank you, Commissioner Barnhart. Welcome everybody to our presentation this afternoon. Thank you for joining us. A couple little additions I would like to add to the presentations and comments so far, just in the point of clarity. We received direction from Department of State today that those ballots received after 8 p.m. on Election Day through Friday are now going to be put aside for the time period. There are some challenges currently pending before the United States Supreme Court. So we got notification from the Department of State that we're going to have to put those aside for now. We don't have clear direction. As soon as we get clear direction from the Department of State and potentially the Supreme Court, we'll know what we're going to do with them. But people should not mail them in just because we have that clarity. But I just want to clarify, at this point in time, it's a little bit up in the air what's going to happen with those ballots received after 8 p.m. on Election Day. As a follow-up to that issue, so people can be rest assured that their ballot is going to count, I want to remind people that if they have an absentee or a mail-in ballot, they are not turning those completed ballots in at their polling location. Polling locations are not an appropriate place to turn in your completed ballot. You need to drop them in the election services office, or you need to put them in one of the two drop box locations. So please, please do not go to your polling location on Election Day with your completed ballot and ask them to accept it for you. They will not be accepting completed ballots at that point in time. So I want to stress that. In addition, following up on some of Ron's comments with what's happening at the polling place on Election Day, I do want to follow up and say, if for some reason you decide that you received your mail-in ballot and you did not want to complete that and vote by that process, and you want to vote at the polling location on Election Day, you need to bring that entire packet with you to your polling location on Election Day. So you would be bringing your mail-in ballot uncompleted, your secrecy envelope, all the materials that you received in the mail, and bring that to your polling location if for some reason you decide you want to vote on the machines on Election Day. It is critical that we receive all those materials back once either an absentee or a mail-in ballot was issued to you for Election Day. If you complete all those materials back and you certify that you have not voted by any other means, you will be permitted to vote on the machines on Election Day. If you don't return those items, then you would be required to vote by provisional ballots. So just so there's clarity. In addition, so I know some people are concerned because they may have waited till close to yesterday's deadline to request a mail-in ballot. If for some reason you do not receive your mail-in ballot in sufficient time, or you don't have an opportunity to return your mail-in ballot by the deadline, you do have the option to potentially go to the polls and vote. Depending on what the circumstances, it will be determined how you can vote. Most likely it will be by a provisional ballot. but I don't want people to be concerned if for some reason they didn't get their mail-in ballot because they didn't request it till yesterday, and we didn't receive that application till later on this week. You still have the opportunity to exercise your right to vote on Election Day. It just may be by provisional ballot. So I encourage people, if you have any questions, please call the Election Services Office. I will be working all day long on Election Day. My assistant, Cody Kaufman, will be working as well with me. We have people here to answer your questions if you don't have clarity about whether or not you can vote on Election Day. Let me move on to the topic of watchers and observers on Election Day. Poll watchers, as shown on the screen, will be issued a certificate by Election Services. At this point in time, we've issued approximately 100 poll watcher certificates. Poll watchers are appointed by the parties as well as the candidates, depending on what the case may be. They are there generally in the polling location. They're, you know, hearing people's names announced when they come in to vote. They may review the number list of voters when there's no voters present in the polling location. They're allowed under certain circumstances to ask questions, but they're interacting with the judge of elections on Election Day. So poll watchers in the polling place is not anything any voters should be concerned about. That's part of the normal process in terms of that. And it's more questions about an elector's identity or the like, or eligibility to vote. So poll watchers is something that isn't really a change in terms of a normal Election Day activity. Where we do have a change, recent change, is to our observers for the polling locations or polling locations where we are going to canvass the ballots in the pre-canvass. So each of the candidates, as well as the parties, are permitted to appoint observers that will be over at the DoubleTree location, or as we move over to the 13th floor of the Services Center, they will be allowed to observe. And their roles and functions are very much like their title, an observation function. There will be designated areas that are set aside for those individuals. Only one from each candidate and one from each party will be allowed in the room at one time. Commissioner Barnhart and also our HR director, Jessica Wheatneck, will be checking these people in as they go over to the DoubleTree to observe the process. Questions will be directed to Commissioner Barnhart. If these individuals have questions, they are not going to be interfacing and asking questions directly of the county staff that is working that process. It is not permitted for anybody to take photographs or videotape that process over there. The county, as Commissioner Barnhart has articulated, is filming the process in terms of their observers and their role over there at the DoubleTree. We're asking everybody to wear a mask if you're serving that function, to recognize the social distancing parameters that we've set up there so everyone can be in a safe role in terms of that function. You know, the other thing is the individuals, as we open the ballots on Election Day, we're going to be uploading information onto cartridges that will contain the results. We are not permitted to disclose any results of any scanning of the mail-in ballots prior to the close of polls. So it won't be till the end of the close of polls that we will be disclosing any information regarding what is happening with the scanning process that's going to be occurring during the day. In addition, any watchers that are present during the day are not allowed to divulge or discuss any results they may observe while they're in that process. So I know the commissioners on a regular basis has asked questions about disclosing some of those results and asking us to hold on to them until all the ballots are received. That is not something we're prepared to do at this point in time because we have obligations to report certain information to Department of State. Certainly, we're going to be transparent in terms of what we're reporting in terms of precinct numbers, the ballots totals, and that sort of thing. And once we get additional guidance from the Department of State, we will follow that process for the additional ballots that are received on election night and thereafter. The key with ballots received after election day is that it has that postmark that it was mailed by election day in order for it to count in terms of the process that goes on after that. In addition, there are provisional ballots that the election board will have to go through to determine whether or not somebody is eligible and appropriately voting by a provisional ballot. And those are items that'll have to be decided by the election board before those items are totaled. So I understand some people don't want us to report partial results. We will be reporting partial results, but just because we're reporting partial results doesn't mean the results from Berks County are final. And that has happened many times over the years with election, with a very close race where provisional ballots and the counting of other ballots that were received, in this case after the fact, potentially, depending on how close, can change the result of an election. So rest assured, we will make every effort to count every ballot received that is in accordance with what the law requires and what directive we have in terms of any court guidance that we get regarding how these things should be appropriately handled. But again, I would stress people, if you have questions, please feel free to call the Election Services Office. If it's a legal matter, they'll certainly refer it to my office. We encourage all Berks County registered voters to vote on election day, whether it's done through a process of a mail-in or absentee ballot that you may have requested already. As Commissioner Barnhart explained, that deadline has expired in terms of that. But it's important that we really go out and support this important citizen responsibility to engage in this process. The polls will be open to 8 o'clock. If you're in line by 8 o'clock, you will be permitted to vote. And that's another key point to point out. As long as you're in line by 8 p.m. on election day, you will have the opportunity to vote. It's really unclear to us at this point in time how long the lines may be on election day, because we don't know how many of the remaining people that have not voted by mail-in ballot may go to the polls. But rest assured, those polls will remain open until every person that was in line by not 8 o'clock gets through and gets the opportunity to cast their vote. So it's an exciting time here at Berks County to see so many citizens engage in the process. It's encouraging that people are passionate about the issues that are faced today. It's an exhausting time for the election services staff as well, but I want to thank everybody for their patience. I know some people are frustrated, but please reach out to us if you have questions. We'll do our best to get you the answers you need so that you can exercise your rights.
Thank you, Christine and Ron, for your thorough analysis of what's taking place. And it capturing all of this, the overwhelming majority of the rules and responsibilities we have to follow are dictated by the state and the courts. And one of the interesting things where people are hesitating to fill out that mail-in ballot or get it in, I assure you, with this new information about this court case that's still pending, if you're sitting on that mail-in ballot or sitting on an absentee ballot, don't wait any longer. Don't expect there to be any extension of time. Make your decision. If you're not going to use that ballot, you need to surrender it at the polls if you go in to vote in person. I recognize there are people that may change their mind and say, I'd rather vote in person, but you can't go in that polling location without proof that you received that mail-in ballot. You will be turned away. So recognizing we have 202 polling locations throughout Berks County, only 18 out of 202 have been relocated to other facilities due to COVID-related issues. They have all been sent letters. Any voters in those districts have been sent letters several weeks ago notifying them of the changes. One in particular is the Santander Arena will again be housing 4 city precincts. thank you to the Convention Center Authority again for their support of this great endeavor. And in particular, Exeter 3, which is now for this election at the Neversink Rod and Gun Club at Painted Sky Road. We have received support from Exeter Police and the Fire Police to provide traffic support at that location. So I think far and away we have done everything humanly possible. Are we human? Yes. Do we make mistakes? Yes. But I think with the attention to detail by our leadership staff here and our election services and our board, I think we're going to have a real, real good day. People are going to exercise their right to vote. And one of the things, again, has been swelling out there, please don't count this before that, back and forth and back and forth. Our expectation is to have the majority of these votes tabulated out of the precincts and out of the scanners by election night. Now, recognizing the polls are open till 8. So those results are going to start trickling in. People still be standing in line after 8 o'clock. So don't sit there at 9 o'clock or 10 o'clock and say, are they the total results of Berks County? I would dare say it's going to be much later that evening for the large majority of the votes to be tallied. So again, that'll only be an unofficial. It takes several weeks till everything is documented and cleared up. The most difficult one is comparing the provisional ballots to the machine count to make sure that the books correspond to persons who voted in on the machine as well as provisional. There is no way that we will permit someone to vote twice. Even though we had people come in this week and say, can I vote by mail and also go to my precinct and vote again? Sorry, that doesn't happen. So let's eliminate the hype and the hysteria and everything you see on social media and on TV. Maybe we can just watch old Western movies for a couple days. There have been a lot of questions and concerns about interpreters. I think we've done an incredible job here in Berks County over the last probably 20 years. Each of the 48 city polls will have an interpreter in person. We have virtual interpreters for the rest of the county. In election services, numbering about 12 interpreters who have direct access through county cell phones to the judges of elections. If there are people out in the other precincts who need election services help, they simply call in and they will receive that help. So I think that wraps up our printed portion of our Q&A, our questions or statements. And now if Jessica Blauser would like to enunciate the questions that we received. Jessica.
Thank you, Commissioner. Michelle Greeley Ackley Shillington, please update your polling locations. There are some boroughs not listed. I had to call the election center yesterday.
So Jessica did contact Karen Barsoom, and the website and votespa.com have been updated. So thank you for noticing that. They both kind of work with each other. The votespa.com is a really good website. Our website's good. But thank you for pointing that out. Those are the kind of things we want to hear from the community. Next question.
Jamie Klein from Senator Judy Schwank's office. Our office have fielded many calls about drop boxes. It was mentioned earlier that Saturday is closed to distribute supplies and that the boxes are not available Sunday. Are there any considerations to change those plans?
The answer is no. We discussed this significantly over the last few weeks. Given the large amount of product that has to be dispersed on Saturday, which takes all of election service workers and additional people to get this done. And for the last month or so, the huge volume of work coming into election services, we need to give our employees a break. When you're working 12 to 14 hours a day, 5 to 6 days a week, you need a break. We need them back here fresh on Monday. Both boxes will be open from 8 to 5 on Monday, November 2nd. And on election day, both boxes will remain open from 8 a.m. to 8 p.m. So there are, I think, ample opportunities for people to drop their ballots off. I know this past Saturday from 8 to 12 at the Ag Center, I think we got 200 ballots. And that was during a period of time when there were literally 1,200 cars dropping off their hazardous waste for the Solid Waste Authority. So people have been dropping their ballots off. Again, they're available. today, Friday. They're available back again Monday, Tuesday. They're available down here in the Services Center. So again, mail-in ballots. If you are holding on to those ballots, you need to make a decision. So the time is running out to get those in. I would not wait to try to get them postmarked on Election Day and cross your fingers that if this court case goes in either direction, that they'll be counted through the course of the week. So any other questions?
We just have one more comment. Mike Toledo Redding wants to let you know, great information, Commissioner Barnhart.
Thank you, Michael. And I want to thank you for everything you've done to help us. I know you've had the effort to get interpreters here to go through our training classes to help us out. And my compliments to you and your team at Central Hispano and everything you're doing for our community. Keep up the good work. Thank you. Any questions from those on the call or my colleagues or anything we missed? Ron, Christine, Christian, Michael. I think we covered a lot of territory in 46 minutes, but I think it was very important to get this information out again, only a scant 6 days before the election. Commissioner Linebaugh.
If you could, Commissioner Barnhart, touch on some of the measures beyond the video that we're doing to deal with security. We haven't talked a lot about it, but there's a security process to make sure the person applying for the ballot is the person they say they are. We're locking the slots of the drop boxes. We've had questions on, has our system election database been hacked in the last 12 months? And I've heard a lot of questions about cybersecurity. If you could, and I'm putting a lot on your plate, but even talk about our machines where people are voting and tabulating are not connected to the internet.
Yes. When you go, thank you, Commissioner Linebaugh, when you go to vote in person, that machine is nothing more than plugged in the wall for power, to power up the system. But there is no connection to the internet. There's no connection to the internet in the database in election services. That's all internal. Nothing's going out into the space. There's nothing going to the cloud or anything else like that. Specifically, the drop boxes are padlocked at night. They are secured. They are verified every morning that there's nothing in there to start the day. And they are completely cleaned out several times a day, logged the exact number by two people. And when they're brought back into election services, they're doubly verified as to if I picked up 500 ballots, 500 ballots were returned to election services. We thought very long and hard about this. We did not want these remote boxes in every corner of the county not being watched, maybe watched by a camera, but recording something is a little bit different than someone standing there making sure that one person can put their ballot in the drop boxes. We're pretty fanatical about following the rules. Would we have liked to open the envelope sooner than 7 o'clock on election day morning? Sure, but guess what? We're following the law. Did we want to just willy-nilly put boxes out and make them somewhat secure? And to Ron's point, maybe somebody throwing something in that box and destroying hundreds, if not thousands, of ballots. We don't want to take that risk. We want to ensure that everyone who decides to vote has the opportunity to vote and can rest assured that that ballot or that ballot at the polls will be counted and counted accurately. Christian started out the meeting by saying, we're an election board. We're not party affiliated when we come to election board. We're doing this for the community. It's a service. It's what commissioners do. States don't run elections. Municipalities don't run elections. Counties do. And when these laws are amended and changed and doctored up and flipped around, the people that really have to carry this out are our election services team and the Board of Elections, and again, our senior staff that have done a remarkable job. And what I would say is just, we've been here for three presidential elections, Commissioner Linebaugh. This will be our third one. Nothing like it before. What I remember is a big uptick in voter registration, and the first one, long lines. But now this one just pales in comparison to the long lines and the other issues we had before. So we're going to get through this, and I think it's going to be a really good outcome that we've done this correctly. We've dotted our I's and crossed our T's to make this thing work.
And if I can add on the security, we just as recently as last week voted to accept cybersecurity software made available to us by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania. And we all know that our Chief Information Officer, Justin Luce, and his team have been invested in cybersecurity in this county for years. And the question isn't, have we ever been attacked? Our system is attacked on a pretty regular basis, as all systems are. It's a question, has there been a hack into our systems? And the answer is no, in large part because our election systems are not connected to the internet. Just one clarification, because some people get confused. The SURE system is a database that is connected to the internet and accessible to counties across the Commonwealth, but that is the state voter registration system, the SURE system. It's different than the database that the county keeps.
Thank you. Thanks for the clarification.
If I can just comment briefly.
Technology changes constantly, so I can sometimes keep up with it. Go ahead, Christine.
I just wanted to comment briefly on the security measures. You know, I've been involved in elections for 20 years now at the county, and I can tell you over the 20 years, we've never run an election with the degree of security standards in place since I've been involved in this process. We talked a little bit about the drop boxes. There's actually two people from the county side and then two deputy sheriffs. You know, each side has their own set of keys. You need both keys to open it up. So not anyone from the county can open those drop box at the Ag Center without the corresponding deputies that have their padlock on the lock. The seals are numbered in terms of locking up the box at the end of the night and also opening in the morning. Those numbers are verified. When the bags transporting the ballots are taken back to the services center, they're locked as well with a seal that must be cut and the number verified. So we really have gone, you know, I believe to the full extent that's responsible for us to do in terms of in guarding the integrity of this process. There's a double count on both ends. Actually, when we harvest the ballots at the Ag Center, there's actually the two election people and the county people that count, as well as the two deputy sheriffs. So it really has taken a village to make this process work. And I really want to commend the county staff as well, that really it's a thankless job for a lot of the people, especially down in election services, for all the long hours they put in. And when we've reached out to county officials and said, we need your help, I appreciate the department heads across the county, as well as the elected officials that have allowed us to borrow staff from their departments. The elected officials and department heads really could have said to us, and the courts as well, could have said to us, no, we're not gonna give up our staff. We have our own operations. And I think it's important for people to understand it's the county organization as a whole that is banded together to make this process as smooth as possible for the voters of Berks County.
And I want to add to that a little bit. When you have 250 to 300, because we have people on a waiting list to help us on election day, that says something about the caliber of people that work for the county. Any other questions or comments? Now's your time to field them. Okay. If there is nothing further, this will conclude our media event on Election Day. And everyone stay safe and be well out there until we see you next time. Thank you.